Good evening, everyone. Meet Padma. She is a 13-year-old girl from a place called Kadav in rural Maharashtra. She is very intelligent and wants to become a doctor when she grows up. One day, she went to school and stained her uniform red. Yes, she got her first period and she had absolutely no idea about it. She went back home and told her mother about it, and her mother asked her not to go to school anymore because they did not have the financial needs to support her periods. Shocking, isn't it? It's not just the story of one Padma, but 23% of girls in India drop out of school when they start menstruating, and about 70% of women contract reproductive tract infections. Just imagine, 300 million women in India right now are facing difficulties while urination. And in terms of numbers, this is more than the population of 50 European countries put together. When I first heard about this, I was working in an impeccable investment bank with no speck of dust in its premises. While a majority of women in India were using sand, husk, newspapers to manage their periods. While I was spending more than 100 rupees every month to buy my sanitary napkins, 22% of Indians have a family income which is less than 2,000 rupees a month. It was shocking, and I thought there must be a way we could do something about it. Just like me, Feba was another entrepreneur in a place called Secunderabad, and she thought she should do something for the girls like Padma, and she set up a small manufacturing unit in Secunderabad with the help of 15 village women. Everything was going fine, but then she realized that these 15 women were making only 500 sanitary napkins a day. Now it was very difficult for her to cover all the overheads of production by only selling 500 pads a day. Also, due to the lack of technology and automation, most of the products were not consistent and often of bad quality. It was also difficult for her to be able to sell these products in the market. She started with a noble cause, but was stuck in this conundrum. Again, it's not just her problem. There are thousands of such manual manufacturing units of sanitary napkins, which are promoted by governments, non-profit organizations to create jobs in rural areas. But all of them are barely making their financial ends meet. This took me to a friend, Prateek, who is also an alumnus from IIT Bombay, who was at that time working in a multinational company that was producing sanitary napkins. I was really curious, what are you guys doing so right and how are you producing such good quality pads? He told me that it takes $15 million or 100 crore rupees to set up a manufacturing unit. And these machines produce almost a million pads a day. Now, to be able to sell a million pads a day, you need a lot of people in between. So from the producer to the final women, there are 6 intermediaries. You start from a super stockist to a stockist to a distributor to a wholesaler to a retailer, and finally it reaches the consumer. By the time it reaches the consumer, it is almost 60% more expensive. Also, if you look at the cost of a sanitary napkin, 15 to 20% of the costs are also into advertising. That's how you see a sanitary napkin ad every 2 minutes on TV. This is not an easy problem. Now just look at a small scale business owner. Can you imagine someone putting in 100 crore rupees and also having the network to be able to sell a million pads a day? A lot of developing countries have been really slow in adopting the industrial revolution. Infrastructure came in late, transportation has been poor. Now it makes really difficult for us to rely on business models that worked in developing countries. For example, long distance distribution, which is the heart of FMCG industry, is not just ineffective, but also very costly. There are special countries like Nepal, which have small sized populations. Now for them, the size of a sanitary napkin industry itself is just $10 million because there are such few women. And the cost of setting up a manufacturing unit is $15 million. There's no incentive for a large scale manufacturer to set up a manufacturing unit in Nepal. And they have to rely on imports, which makes these pads really expensive. This made us think that why is there something not in between these high-speed automation machines and these low-tech manual machines? This was our Eureka moment. And we designed the world's first automatic and compact machine to make sanitary napkins at a small scale. When we started talking about it, an entrepreneur named Ariful in a place called Dhaka in Bangladesh heard about this. At that time, he was working in the garment industry, which is known and is famous for employing hundreds and thousands of women. Most of these women rely on the reused, recycled cloth that is discarded in the fabric industry. He wanted to change that. For him, it took less than 25 lakh rupees or $30,000 to set up the entire manufacturing unit, and he has a production capacity of making 4.5 lakh pads or 450,000 pads every day. He's able to serve the demand of about 30,000 women. For him, it's truly a social yet profitable business. It also gives me immense pride to share that his pads are not just reaching the garment workers, but he has also been working extensively with NGOs to provide these pads to Rohingya refugees. Again, just like Ariful, there are 18 other entrepreneurs who have adopted this model of decentralized production and distribution across 6 developing countries. It is also interesting to note that 80% of them are in tier 2, tier 3 towns. This not just creates job opportunities in these areas, but also reduces the burden of migration to urban cities, which is a challenging problem with most developing countries. So let's come back to Mumbai. A few hundred kilometers from here is Sapna, who is a village entrepreneur in a place called Karjat. Since she is directly procuring pads from our Mumbai production unit, she is able to make 9 times the distribution margin that she was making through government schemes and distribution of other products. For her, it's more than just making money. She is the menstrual health champion of her community, and people really respect her. She also helped us conduct a small survey in her community, with which we realized that 90% of women who were procuring pads from her were doing so because it was available directly in their villages, and a woman no longer had to travel 5 to 6 kilometers just to procure a sanitary napkin. Amazing, isn't it? We, a bunch of engineers, just developed a technology and how it is impacting so many different aspects of people's lives. It brings me back to the question of industrialization. You know, we talk a lot about it. Can industrialization be equitable? That means, can it provide equal opportunities to people of different income segments? So for this, let's go back a few hundred years in history. The first industrial revolution started with the invention of steam engine, which made transportation possible. Now you could send people and goods from one part of the country to the other, which in effect steamed in the next industrial revolution, which was high-speed manufacturing. Now you could make, now there was sophisticated machinery that could make complex products at large scale, bringing down the cost of production and increasing consistency. Though it heavily relied on the first industrial revolution, and most developing countries were late in adopting both these industrial revolutions. The third one is more recent, which is information technology, which came to almost all the developing countries and developed countries almost at the same time. It made communication much better. Today, we are in a very interesting time. Hardware technologies have become really cheap and modular. Just look at a few examples. 3D printers have made prototyping really easy as well as fast. On the other hand, if you look at solar cells, now with solar panels, you are able to provide electricity to all those remote areas that were outside and in darkness because of the lack of access to the centralized electricity grid. On the other hand, if you see, data is very easy to collect, store, and transmit, which has led to IoT coming in, which is Internet of Things, which has again led to industrial IoT. For just to look at the impact of all these things and how it is affecting a small business like us, we are now able to provide maintenance services using industrial IoT to all these decentralized machine units. You may imagine it's so difficult to maintain all these different units in different parts of the country, but with this, we are able to provide service, and even using artificial intelligence, we can predict a problem before it occurs. Just imagine what can happen if we bring these technologies beyond the industry of sanitary napkins. For example, to agriculture. What if a farmer had a machine that could upscale the grains to some finished processed good? He would be able to make much more margins. Imagine what it could do to retail, FMCG companies. It would not just bring the production price down, but distribution would be local and focused. It would also impact a lot of people who were left out of the first few industrial revolutions because of the lack of access. I believe this is the new industrial revolution. This is the industrial revolution 4.0. This is not just equitable, but sustainable and humane. Thank you.